welcome to the Bored Expat channel. Today, as promised, I'm going to be talking about this, which is my 2017 Honda Africa Twin. If you are new to the channel, then please do hit that subscribe button, and if you did like the videos, then please do give it a thumbs up. So before I go into the details about this bike and everything that it has, I think it's important to mention why I bought it, and a lot of that comes down to not only where you live, but also the motorcycles that you've had in the past, if you're new to motorcycling and things like that. So, for me in particular, I started riding a motorcycle when I was 16 years old. So in the UK, you were allowed to ride a 50cc at that age. So I had a Suzuki SMX50, which is like a supermoto type thing. I'll try and put a picture on the screen for you. So I had that, it's a great little bike. It's great to learn all the basics and stuff like that. But I always wanted sports bikes. That was always, as most kids are as well, they just love sports bikes, and it's all about the sports bikes. So when I was 17 and a half, I got a Kajiva Mito 125, and that was a fantastic little bike. It looked just like a Ducati 916, which was my favourite bike at the time. Really quick as well. So when I bought it, it was restricted to 12 and a half brake horsepower, but I took it to a shop, paid a guy about 50 or 60 pounds, and he de-restricted it and took it to 33 brake horsepower. And it was good for nearly 100 miles an hour. It was a brilliant little bike. Then I took a small gap for only about a year or so, maybe two max. And then I wanted to do my full bike license. So I must have been 20 years old, something like that. In fact, no, I must have been 21 because I did my direct access at that time. So after I passed that, I passed it first time, I bought a Suzuki SV650S. And that was one of the reasons I bought it. I was quite young at the time, and they were doing a very good interest deal, loan deal on it. So it was 0% interest and stuff like that. And it was a good bike. It was a V-twin. So I had that bike for quite a long time, actually. I took it all around Europe. My knee down on it the first time. It was a really, really good bike. It was bulletproof. It was a great little engine. It didn't have didn't handle, but it had had a pretty good engine. Then it was time to step up to something a bit more sporty. So I bought a 2008, but it was a K7. It was a Suzuki GSXR 750. What a beautiful bike. I mean, it was amazing. It was a really good condition. I'll put a couple of pictures on because it was a real special bike. Had a lot of fun on that as well. Took it to the Nürburgring, as I did with the SV as well. It's a really good bike. Few little issues with it. Had a terrible flat spot. It must have been something to do with the emissions. It was in like fourth gear, sort of early revs. It was just dull. It would just lull, and it just wouldn't. It was a great bike. I mean, I bought it because it was supposed to be the ultimate bike. 1,000 is too powerful, and a 600 you want a bit more. It was great, but it was all at the top end, and you're doing silly speeds by that time, and half of the fun is the lower end of the rev range for me. So then something big happened, and I moved to Poland. So I shipped my bike over, so the GSXR 750, and then I soon realised that the roads in Poland are absolutely terrible. And for one of my birthdays, girlfriend at the time took me to a motocross track or an enduro track for just a day. And it blew my mind. It sort of changed my world, because all the time as a kid, I was always concentrating on sports bikes. That's all I wanted to have. And then when I experienced off-roading for the first time, it was like opening up a whole new world to me. So it wasn't long after that before I got my second bike. So I sled the GSXR, and I bought a KTM 690 Enduro. And I can't say enough good things about it, but also bad things about that bike. I mean, it was amazing. It's 690 single. It was a 2005, and it was a really early version of the EFI, and it was a pig. It did break down a lot, but when it went, oh my God, was it fun. I mean, I raced it. I took it on enduro events where I had no right to be there, and I was going up against really proper enduro bikes and doing all right. It was fantastic. It was the jack of all trades and the king of none. I tried to take it on long trips, and the saddle was terrible. again, racing it, it did have its limitations as well, but what a fantastic bike. I mean, if you're not doing long distances, I can't rate it enough. It was a fantastic bike. In fact, I'd go so far as to say that I would very much like another one one day, just for, you know, the short riding, blasting around the forest and stuff like that, because it is really, really good fun. So then I had the two bikes, and then as I was doing a bit more racing at the time, I was only amateur stuff, I realised I needed something a bit more serious for off-roading, and at that point I bought a Husqvarna TE449 Enduro. The reason I chose that bike was because, again, it was a fantastic deal, because they were just in the process of being bought by KTM, so these were the BMW versions. I'll put a picture of the bike up, you'll know what I mean. And I got it for a stupid price, brand new. It was like £5,000, whereas the KTMs at the time were like 7.5, nearly 8. And I'm no professional, so it really not going to make much of a difference to me. I'm a big guy, so I'm 6'4", so I decided to take a 450. In some respects, regret that. I would have liked, thinking back on it now, a two-stroke would have been pretty cool, because they're so light and nimble. So then I had three bikes, and then the KTM kept breaking down. I wasn't riding the Suzuki at all, so I decided to sell the KTM, sell the Suzuki, and buy this. So let's talk about it first. So I bought this bike from Honda in Warsaw. I actually pre-ordered it, so before the first ones were ever being delivered, I'd already put my deposit down. As it happens, a friend of mine in the town where I live also did the same, but he had his deposit down a bit earlier. So I went to the shows and looked at it, and it just seemed to tick all the boxes for me. It wasn't ridiculous money, it wasn't GS money. I'm in an R-ing whether to go for an F800 GS. But in the end, I thought, you know, this is a brand new bike. The GS had been out for a long time, so let's give it a try. And I can't say I've been disappointed with it at all. I've taken it. We've been to Norway for 2 weeks on it. I've been to Romania on it. Went to Ukraine on it as well. And it's been flawless, as you'd expect with a Honda. It's just reliable and does what you want. Lacks a little bit of excitement, but. Let me show you around the features and some of the changes that I've done to the bike. Okay, so if you're anything like me and you're half interested in something, you'll usually take a look on YouTube and look at the reviews and everything on them. So I won't go into all the details, but I'll try and cover some of the things that aren't commonly talked about in the videos. So starting off, what have I changed on the bike? So the first thing I changed was these, which are the Bark Busters. So the ones that come with the bike are just flimsy plastic, there's no strength to them, and I thought, because I am going to ride it off-road, and I do quite frequently, that I should get those changed out. Wasn't an expensive purchase really, but you can see they're solid metal there. Well, I think it's Ali. They ain't going nowhere, and just save you if you do drop it. I also bought the Garmin Zumo sat-nav. Which has been very good. You get all the Europe maps on it, or if you're in America as well, then you get all the maps for your country. So very, very useful, and use it a lot. So what else have I done? I did the SW Motec rack on the back here. It's very simple to install. It just bolts straight on. A lot of use out of that. You'd have seen that on my trip to Lithuania video with the bike. I'll put a link up so you can take a look at that if you're interested. And then finally, I changed the tyres. So the stock tyres that come with it are a very road-based tyre. So I was looking at options on the tyres, and I know the Continental TKC 80s are very, very popular, but I wanted something that would give me a bit more longevity in terms of when I have to replace the tyres. So what I did was something that's a little bit unusual. I actually read about it in a book about adventure motorcycling from someone who did a lot of it all around the world. And what his advice was buy a more road-based rear tyre, which in this case is a TKC 70 that was fairly new out, I believe. And then an aggressive front, even a motocross tyre on the front, to give you that grip when you're off-road.
And I can say that the combination's been very, very good, to be honest with you. So I've got that confidence on the front end. The rear's going to slide about still if I'm really going off-road quite a lot. But I've got very good life out of this. So I changed the tyres, I think, at the first service. And now the bike's got 17,000 kilometres, so just over 10,000 miles on it. So very good life out of those tyres. I can't say I'm disappointed at all on that. And that's all I have changed on this bike. The things I would like to change are the windscreen. It's terrible. I bought a helmet with a peak on it. In fact, I'll show you quickly. So I bought this, and it actually had the peak on it, similar to my motocross helmet here. And oh my God, it was terrible at speed. It would try and blow my head off, or it was just so uncomfortable and noisy that, it just wasn't having it. So in the end, I just took it off, and that's, you know, that's how I ride it at the moment. So that's definitely one thing I would change in the future. I also bought a tank bag. So if I show you this, this is the mounting section for it. Again, this is made by SW Motec. Very clever. So this just bolts onto your normal tank arrangement. And I'll just grab the bag and I'll show you how it fits on. So bear with me. So this is the bag itself. And as you can see on the bottom here, there is a plastic part, and there's a metal with a rope part on it. And you pull that, and I don't know if you can see, that's how you release it from the tank. So there's no straps, no messing about. And all you do, just put it into place. And that's it. And it's in place and it's going nowhere and it does not touch the tank at all. And that was one of my concerns with it, is that I thought, you know, it's going to rub the paint out. And it's very, very good, especially when it's loaded. I mean, now it's, you can see, but it's not going anywhere. Very, very good purchase. And when you're going to fill up the fuel, there's no problem. You just literally pull it, take it off, and there you go, you fill up. So very, very good and very, very useful. I'd certainly recommend that to anybody who's looking for a decent tank bag. So let's talk about some of the features of the motorcycle. I'll start by turning on the ignition. So you can see what we have here. We've got the fuel gauge, we've got the speedo, we've got the rev gauge, and then got the neutral time, outside air temperature, average consumption, mileage, and then you've got your temperature at the bottom. You've then got your displays, so you've got your indicator lights, which are nice. You know, you're not going to forget that on. Neutral temperature warnings, ABS, traction control, oil, and the engine lights. And you've got some others there, I'm sure, that will come on if the worst comes to the worst. So to go through the menus of it, fairly simple, to be honest with you. All you've got is you've got a set, and then you've got an up and a down. So if I tell you what I'm doing, so that's set, that's up, and that's down, okay? So you can see you've got a little arrow here. So when you press the up and the down, you go through trips, A, B, and then back to total. If you hit the set button, that little arrow there will start blinking. You can move it up to this section. You press set again to leave it, and then you can go through other options. So you've got average speed, average consumption, trip, average. Yeah, again, you can press the set button again and go up to the next one, which you've got your outside, where your temperature, elapsed time, and that's it. So fairly basic, nothing too complicated on it. I did also opt for the heated grips. So as you press that, because these are from Honda, as you press it, it lights up and it flashes, which is a bit disconcerting at night when you're riding, to be honest, because when you turn it on, it's flashing in you, and it's actually brighter than it looks. And then you get an additional thing here, which shows the heated grip. And as you press it, you've got different levels. 1, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then off. Would I recommend them? Nah, not at all. They're not worth the money. I mean, it's nice that it's integrated, and that's why I went for it, but they're not very warm, in my opinion. They're They're okay. If I mean, I wear sort of enduro type gloves anyway most of the time, so it's adequate for me. So I recently bought a set of the Oxford heated grips for my girlfriend's bike. I installed those, and those things are wicked. I mean, you've got five settings again, but 100% is toasty. You don't really want to sit on it with 100%, so you're actually turning it down, whereas this, I've got it on max all the time. So there's a bit of food for thought. They are, you know, they're nice being integrated, and you know, they feel all right, pretty good quality and stuff. But if you're planning on going anywhere really cold, then I would say go for a different option. So the bike also has ABS and traction control. So I'll just show you the options on the traction control. So I have to actually turn the bike on for that, but you've got ABS on the front all the time. You do have the option here to turn off the rear ABS. So you press and hold that button down, and then you'll get this light come on, which is ABS pointing at the rear wheel, just showing you that you can lock up the back wheel should you need to. So the traction control is controlled by this little button here. So this is another weird thing with a Honda. So this is usually your overtake light, you know, your flash, your high beam, and this does traction control. So to flash your high beam, you actually have to push down on this, which is really takes a bit of getting used to be honest with you, and I'm still really not used to it now. I'm still trying to go here to flash people. So yeah, slightly different. So I'll talk you through the traction control. So to do that, you need to turn the actually hit the start button here, or just push it into prime, which primes the fuel pump and everything. You then get the T on, and you've got three bars. So you've got full, which is default setting, 2, 1, it goes to 3 again, but if you press and hold it, it goes traction control fully off. Okay, so what do I think of the ABS and the traction control? Well, the ABS is very good, can't fault that. It's extremely good. I've never had a bike with ABS before, and fantastic. Off-road, I've never had it cut in when I really didn't want it to, and I've always got the option to turn it off should I really need to. But you know, people talk about it as essential and stuff like that, but I rode a lot off-road, and I've never really needed it. Maybe I'm not pushing as much as some of the others, but traction control, however, I can't say anything good about that. I know that they've just brought out a newer version of the software, so you've got a slightly different dash, and I think you've got now 5 or 7 settings on the ABS. For me, the standard one, you pull away and give it beans and it cuts in. You're not spinning a tire, it just cuts out. You try to wheelie the thing, it just will not. It's just interrupting all the time. So my default is I change it from 3 down to 1, or it's off. I mean, with 1 it's okay, but if you want to get the arse end out, then to be honest, I think it's just better turning it off, and you can control it with your own wrist. I mean, if you're going to be doing that kind of riding anyway, then you know, for me, I mean, I don't know if you're racing, but you're not going to, this isn't a racing bike, so I don't know. I think it's good if you were traveling long distances or something like that, and it's pissing down, and you're worried about you know, it's really bad, and you're worried about traction. It could probably save you, you know, by having it on its fullest setting. But I think for most experienced riders, it's just a bit too obtrusive. So yeah, that's my thoughts on that. Also, there is one thing I forgot to mention, which is on the subject of luggage. So I talked about the tank bag. I also bought the Honda panniers. So again, mixed reviews on that. So I know if you were doing trips around the world and you were going doing a lot of off-roading, then you know, you go for your Touratech or your whatever, and you get all the, you know, you get all the racks and everything that goes on it, and you fill the thing up with luggage. But for me, if I'm lucky, I do 1 to 2 week-long trips a year. Usually it's 1 if I'm lucky. I might do the odd overnighter like I did in Lithuania, but when I need to take a large amount of luggage, I ordered the Honda ones just because, you know, I was in the dealership and I fell for all those you know, we'll have that and have that, did me a good deal on it, stuff like that. So let me show you it, and then I'll tell you my opinion of it. I think for what I use it for, it's not been a bad purchase at all. I know there's a lot better ones out there, but it kind of does suit my my needs for now. So let me show you. Okay, so this is the pannier itself. So we've got brushed aluminium on the front, the Honda logo, and that's then onto a ABS type plastic with the hooks at the back to connect. You do use the motorcycle key to do that, so that's one nice thing. But you do have these really cheapy looking catches here. If I get the key out, I can just show you how you open it. So you put the key in, these positions, you've got a lock, which you can't do anything with. When you open it, you can then open this, which is the release, and you can also open these. So they're really flimsy and not very good quality at all. And also, when you open the box itself, you've got loads of room in it, it's quite nice. It does have the little bits of rubber here which you can connect, which means that the bag will only open that much, but again, that's no good either, because you want it open to get stuff out. You're not going to just ram it in like that, so I've not had any use for those at all. So to be honest with you, they've done me no favours, these little things. In terms of waterproofness of it, I can't complain. I've never got anything wet. You can see how clean it is on the inside there. When you actually load it and then you come to close it, I've had problems in the past where it's not, you know, left a bit, right a bit, it won't close. But once you do, you know, then you can pull these down and get it into place. So, you know, for my use, I can't really complain too much, but you can make your own judgment on that. So how you connect it to the bike is pretty cool, and it is nice. So you know, the bike's got a nice clean appearance before you put them on. So you put the key into the open position, open that up, put on the passenger footrest here, that one slides onto there, then got the two at the top, push them down, and then you just close that lever and it's on. So that's it in place. So you've got handles there as well, but as you can see, one of the little rubbers has fallen out of mine. Again, I've not been careless with it. So you can see the amount of play in it. So what I have to do now is put a bit of cloth or I might even 3D print something that will go in there just to keep it secure. At the bottom, you know, you do have a bit of movement there. I mean, if you're going to be jumping the thing, you shouldn't have luggage on anyway. So again, it's been all right. If I just show you that, so taking it off is very, very easy as well. So just like I've done, just lift that handle up, just grab the bag, pull the handle, up she goes and away, and the bike's back to standard. So that is a nice thing about it. So if I show you the rubbers I was telling you about, so on the bottom of these hooks, I don't know if you can see here, but there's a little rubber grommet. And that sits into place just to hold it secure, and you can see it's fallen out here. I don't have it, and yeah, it's a bit of a shame that, because I haven't used them an awful lot. So yeah, I don't know. If I ever did buy a different set of luggage, it would be because I'd be doing long trips. So I've spent the money, so I'm not going to change it now. They don't seem that bad. I can live with it for now anyway. So let's talk about the other features of the bike. So in terms of suspension, it's very soft up front. I have made some adjustments to the preload on it. The back's pretty nice. You do feel the difference on that, especially when you're two up with luggage. Adjusting the preload does make a difference. So that's pretty much covered all the features. If I've missed anything that you do have that you do want to know about, then please do leave me a question in the comments below, and I'd love to hear your motorcycle history as well. So where you're at now and what got you there, and you know, what made you get to that point. So I'll now give you my full-on conclusion of the bike. So let's start off with, obviously, the main question is, am I happy with the purchase of the bike? I'd say in general I am.
hasn't disappointed me. As a rider that does like going off-road, it is extremely soft. The front suspension is very poor, in my opinion. I think they have revised that slightly on the latest version. So if you did buy a bike now, I think they've, especially on the adventure version, which has got the bigger fuel tanks and stuff like that, go on their website if you want to have a look. It's slightly different to this. But even the standard version, I think, has upgraded internals on the suspension. It just dives. A friend of mine rode this, who's got a GS as well, a brand new one, and it was the standout feature for him that was like, my bike doesn't do that at all. It's, you know, it's really unnerving when you hit the brakes. The front just dives like that. So riding it off-road, I'm not confident on it like I would have been with the KTM. And I think in some respects, KTM kind of spoiled me on it because it was so plush. It was brilliant suspension. That this just doesn't compare with it. It's just a completely different thing. As for everything else with it, the reliability of it, comfort, everything like that, riding with a pillion, riding with luggage, can't fault it. So it's been fantastic. I think if you're going to go around the world on something, then this would be the type of thing to go for because of the reliability. You've got the dealer network of Honda is global, whereas KTM dealers can be few and far between. BMW as well. That's one thing. Also, it's not too technically advanced. It does have traction control, yes, it does have ABS. Both of those technologies have been out for a long time now and they're trusted. A lot of the new bikes now, it seems that manufacturers are just chucking as much technology as possible on it, lean angle ABS, and you know, all the things you can think of, cruise control and things like that. Cruise control, I wouldn't mind it, to be honest. It would be nice. I mean, this does have cable throttle. The new one does have fly-by-wire. You know, this doesn't have it, but do I miss it, really? Nah, I've never had it before, so you don't miss what you haven't had. It's value for money. I think it's very good value for money. I paid for this just over 10,000 or 11 with all the extras. Also got the center stand, I forgot to mention that, but there's, you know, not much to talk about now. It's just a center stand, but it is useful, as you can see. I'm sitting here talking to you now without worrying about the bike falling over. Am I going to keep it? I've been thinking long and hard about this. So I've had it for getting on 2 years. Well, I have had it 2 years now. So it's out of warranty now, so I'm going to be doing all the servicing myself this year. Definitely not changing it this year. It's a couple of bikes that do take my fancy, I won't lie. I've got the KTM 790 Adventures coming out end of this year or early next year. I will be taking a close look at it, because if it was anything like the KTM 690 that I had, but a bit more comfortable and still got a similar power to weight ratio, then I'd be definitely interested in looking at it. Anything else I think in terms of the GS and stuff like that, I'd be scared to take it off-road, I think. And I do want to go off-road, so that's kind of out of the question as well. And the big KTMs as well, just too much money. I don't know what the 790 is going to be in terms of price, but if it's around that £10,000 mark, then you know, it might be possible to trade this in swap it over. But again, I've not made a decision on it. It's just my girlfriend has got her own motorcycle, so she's got a Honda Trans Alp 750. Again, if you want me to talk about that, then I'd be more than happy to. So I don't need really that seat anymore, so I do have the options on bikes to get something more aggressive. So that's, I don't know, it's something to consider. But I think it's a very good bike, and if you are in particular thinking about purchasing one of these, and you've got any comments, like I say, just let me know, and I'll give you my opinion on it. So that's pretty much it. So thank you very much for watching. I know it's been a long video, and I look forward to seeing you on the next one.